suits you.
Right, great. So thank you, Susan. Nice to see everybody. Let me try to wake everybody's Tuesday morning post MLK Day brains up just a little bit to get everyone thinking on this notion of where you guys are going in terms of thinking about the future of higher education by just reminding everyone that we live at an important moment historically where the industrial model of education, both K-12 and post-secondary education, peaked in the case of K-12 50 years ago in terms of its impact, productivity, and power, and about 40 years ago in terms of higher education. Now, it's really hard for those of us embedded in institutions of higher education, particularly those that are very research intensive or research focused, to understand this because we see our families, we see our children, we see the people that we live with, we see our colleagues, we see their families. We don't really grasp yet fully the entirety of the unmitigated failure that we are now deeply, deeply embedded in. What are the best indicators of that failure? Nobody even knows what 70 microns is. Nobody knows what RNA is. The population is not much more literate than they were 100 years ago with the flu virus, the flu epidemic 100 years ago. And you can argue against that, but I'm just telling you that we've done a terrible job. Terrible job. Second, we still have 20% of children going to high school not graduating in the United States, not graduating. And 30% more for 50% total who are graduating from high school who are not competent for a 21st century economy. 50%. In the United States, we have in the college level, you might not know this statistic, but we have 35 million people in the United States that went to college and never finished. Majority of them voted for Trump. The vast majority of them voted for Trump. They never finished, but they have debt. More than 50% of all the people that have started college in the United States since 1960 never finished. More than half the people that have had Pell Grants since 1980, grants from the government to enable them to go to college, have no degree and no certificate. So one thing I think that's really important in a workshop like this that's looking at where we are and where we aren't and what we're doing is that our system didn't evolve and it has peaked some time ago and we're suffering dramatic consequences because of that. Social consequences, social scale ignorance, inability to adjust, inability to drive the economy forward, inability to adapt, lack of understanding, lack of comprehension capability, and deep and deeper and making even deeper levels of resentment. The levels of resentment in the 70 million people that voted for Trump, just to put this into perspective, I don't know if you look at the details, not the outcome of the election, but what do they think? It's beyond belief. Beyond belief. 70 to 80% of the people that voted for that particular ticket don't believe scientists. Now you can think that that's ideological. That isn't ideological only. It isn't ideological only. Since the year 2000, just 20 years, 40% of all jobs available to people with a high school diploma or less are gone. Gone. We're not able to sustain economic growth higher than 2-3% at most. We don't have anything like we used to have, nothing. So what's the causality of this? Limited rates of innovation, limited adaptability to complexity, little understanding of complexity in the educational world, slow adaptation, slow change, a resistance by the faculty to innovation, resistance to technology, unbelievable arrogant ignorance by faculty and elite educated individuals so high that there's actual resentment towards them. And we're careening towards the path, believe it or not, and I'm going to say this boldly, where it's going to become revolutionary over these kinds of things. Exclusivity is now, I'm still on causality, exclusivity is still the coin of the realm in higher education. The more exclusive, the more limited the number of people admitted to a high school, a private high school, an elite Stuyvesant high school, a Bronx science school, a Brooklyn science school, A low percentage admission university, that is status. All status is granted through exclusivity. How can there be exclusivity in educational attainment necessities that are required for a society to actually work at 330 to 350 million people? And the last element of causality is that the universities decided to divide up into two categories: excellence only, admit only A students from high school, and access only, where all the faculties are unionized, there's very low graduation rates, and nothing but constant fighting and social upsetness. Now, perhaps you guys are all aware of all this. Don't know if you are or not, but these causalities are dramatic. What's the response? Well, the system level response is impossible. It's impossible. So there's only been the possibilities for institutional level response. And we're one of the few institutions, not the only, but one of the few institutions that decided to take on response to this unbelievably negative set of social outcomes, derivative of an archaic, anti-innovation, anti-technology, elitist education system, which produces now the assignment of social class as the outcome. We decided to take it on by designing a new kind of university, because the old kind of university either had to make the decision that we were going to be either an excellence-only university where we would admit fewer and fewer students and only students of the highest academic ability out of high school, that is people proven with 1600 SAT scores and A-plus averages and so forth and so on, like most of you and most of us on this screen. That's one of the problems with the faculty, is that they are in fact the very people that they're attempting to cluster themselves around, and unable sociologically to even see this, and unable to even see the cultural impact of this. So finally, some people had to decide, including us, well, maybe it's time for a new kind of university. So we started off on this path about 20 years ago here to build what we call a new American university, one that's actually egalitarian and excellent in the same institution. And we could argue for hours, which I'd be happy to do if I had some hours, we'll pick it up on Saturday or Sunday and argue the entire thing about what egalitarianism really means in a democracy. But it does mean that you might have access to an opportunity to actually be around a great faculty. The problem with that is scale. So the purpose, our response to all of this was to build a university with a new purpose. So we built a university with a charter that has three component parts to it. The first is that we'll measure our success not based on who we exclude. And that might sound funny to you, probably laughing in the back of your heads. We will not measure our success based on the number of the percentage of people we do not admit, because that's the measurement of success now. That was the measurement of success when I was on the deputy provost at Columbia University for 12 years. Did we beat Harvard, Princeton, or Yale in getting more applicants and admitting fewer of them? And that was the object of success. The second element of our charter is that we'll do research, obviously to benefit science and knowledge and the academy and so forth and so on. But we also have to do research that the people who pay for all of that research can actually see and understand and be responsive to. So the reason that people do not understand global climate change in the way that we'd like them to understand it is that they don't understand it because we don't know how to communicate it. We don't know how to connect it. And then lastly, at least within this university model, is that the university will do more than feed itself, more than only produce academics. It will also take some responsibility for outcomes. So if we don't have a sustainability pathway, if we don't have K-12 graduation rates at 90 to 100%, if we don't have this, we don't have this, we don't have this, who's responsible? Well, maybe some of the universities should say they're responsible. So that's part of the response. Now, so new purpose. Then we needed a new design. So we decided to outline 8 new design aspirations. And these were ways in which some universities could depart from the pathway of the design of the historic universities. Cambridge and Oxford, for all of their greatness and all of their achievements, are not egalitarian institutions. They do not scale. They cannot scale. So therefore, how do you scale? Or do you actually believe in Plato's notion that there are just a few people who are actually philosopher kings, who should be treated like philosopher kings, and all the rest are chattel? And I'm using these words on purpose because that's where we've ended up. So new purpose, new aspiration, new culture change. And so this all goes to the notion of what you guys are looking at, which is the future of higher education. The future of higher education has to involve some kind of culture change, because we can't even graduate the students who earn their way into the institutions that we have. Here's a number that's worth noting. So when I was in high school, a freshman in high school in 1970, 7% of the population of the people in the bottom quarter of family incomes, which my family was in, 7% of the people born into those families ever attained a college degree. Today, it's 8%. Only the population is almost twice as large. No change. No change. The top quarter, it's 85%. 85%. Not exactly the kind of institutional structure, institutional design. So culture change means that some institutions of higher education, not all, will have to decide that the students are the most important thing, not the faculty. The community is more important than the faculty, and the faculty are the means, not the end. That doesn't mean you have bad faculty. It means you have great faculty, tremendous faculty. It's just, why are they there? So this then speeds up to, and then I'll quit here in a second, to this notion of technology. There is no way to address any of the issues that I just talked about at either K-12 or the universities without the embracing of technology by at least some universities or some institutions of higher education. It's not possible. You cannot build 5,000 more colleges. I used to be a trustee of a small college in Brunswick, Maine called Bowdoin College. You can't build 5,000 more Bowdoin Colleges. It's a fabulous institution performing a fabulous thing for 1,600 students for $75,000 a year per student. That doesn't scale. It's impossible. It's a small, very powerful leadership academy. Think of it that way. How do you then scale education where you take 100% of the population to an advanced 21st century high school understanding, which means they must understand the basic concepts of algebra. They must understand what a 70 micron ribonucleic acid particle entering your body can do. They must understand all kinds of things that they do not understand. We gave up on teaching math and science to the masses decades ago. Gave up. We're not giving up here. We're doing everything that you can possibly imagine. So the way that we're advancing on technology, I'm looking at your faces. I must be one of your more unusual speakers. And so we're advancing on technology in what we call the five realms of learning. We've got a great video that we can send you about that. Manfred's watched it at least 100 times. So in realm one, and this is really important, that's where we all went to college. That's full immersion, on-campus learning. But you can't build more colleges. So it's kind of funny. It's almost laughable. I mean, I laugh and cry at the same time. Oh, we need more engineers in the United States. We need more people trained in science, technology, engineering, and math. Well, who's added any seats? We need more diversity. Who's added any seats? The only path to diversity right now is to diversify one student body and limit the total number of students that you have. That's the path to our success at the moment. That's how fundamentally, profoundly stupid we are. So we decided to take another look, and I'm just picking engineering. So 10 years ago, we had 6,000 students in engineering on campus. And this year, through Realm One Learning, Realm One, full immersion, technology enhanced learning, we've grown that to 17,000 engineering students. We've taken freshman retention in engineering from 68% to 90%, and we've diversified the class both ethnically and gender wise by a factor of 10. Now, in the world of academia, we can't be any good because we're big. It is literally the case in the culture of academia that the bigger you are, the worse you must be. The more students you have, the less quality you must be able to deliver. Because, of course, you as a faculty member are as ignorant as a turnip. You have no understanding whatsoever about how to do what we have to do. You just pretend that you know something about everything, which of course you don't. So in realm one, we've really embraced realm one, full immersion, on-campus, technology-enhanced learning, and Phil can tell you, we've got every technology tool that humans could build and every one that we could possibly find to enhance our ability to take students from every family background. And this is not mercy. This is education. We've maintained the admission standards of the University of California at Los Angeles from August 10th, 1950. Back then, you could get into that school with a B average if you took the right courses and you had no tuition. What a thing. Doesn't work that way anymore. Works that way here. If you can't pay, we pay. Almost 20,000 students, we cover their entire cost with no support from the state. By the way, we do that. So that's realm one, technology enhanced. Realm two is what we call digital immersion, technology enhanced. In realm one, we have about 75,000 degree seeking students. In what do we have now, Phil, this year, about 80,000 in realm two. And so this is digital immersion, fully immersed, asynchronous learning, technology enhanced learning, 80,000 degree seeking students, including tens of thousands in STEM majors. And some of you that are scientists are saying, oh, that's impossible. How can you teach engineering at high quality to a person that's only dealing with you asynchronously? Well, I don't know, your brain must be pretty weak because you can't think it through. There are ways to do almost anything if you have the right technological tools. So realm two, digital immersion, has become a huge thing, where realm one for us, full immersion on campus, and realm two, digital immersion online, are both highly technologically enhanced. Then there's what we call realm three, digital immersion open scale. This is where we're offering more adaptive classes using adaptive learning technologies. We have an entire biology curriculum of 12 courses in what we call the bio spine, which are instructive back and forth computationally to any learner, allowing individual pathways for learning. We already have 2,000 online biology majors, 4,000 on-campus biology majors. We're going to see both of those accelerating because we're going to see technological capabilities here helping us to do this. And then we have what we call Realm 4 learning, education through exploration. And this is where we've decided that something that you all already know, that there are ways to learn things other than reading a book. You can learn things in the field, but not everybody has the opportunity to get to the field. You can learn things through an exploration modality. And so we've launched a couple of trajectories here. How to Find a Habitable Planet is one trajectory. We've built a partnership with a company called Dreamscape Immersive. What are we spending, Phil, about every shekel we can find, billions of dollars, to try to create an environment where you become the avatar, you visit an alien zoo, you start interacting with species that have been collected from around the galaxy, you are the learner with other students in a fully immersive, avatar-driven virtual reality learning environment where you're the scientist in this learning environment? That's under construction right now, and every aspect of it. And then Realm 5, which is the dream of the dream, and most of us that are, secret, intense liberals, you know, we long for to find ways to educate almost anyone. So there's an object in a science fiction book written by Neal Stephenson called The Diamond Age, called the Young Lady's Illustrated Primer, which is a device that attaches to a child and stays with them throughout their entire life, psychologically enabling them to enhance learning in every possible way, ubiquitously, freely. So that kind of device has about 900 component parts, and we've had a student team working on building each of those component parts over the last 5 years to see if we could build something like this. So the root here is technology, technology, technology at all levels, realm one, realm two, realm three, realm four, realm five. But what's the purpose of all of this? The purpose of all of this is, it turns out, you might have noticed lately that we have a problem or two. You know, the capital of the United States is, you know, surrounded by a division of army troops. You got to decide whether or not some of them are the snipers or not the snipers. You got razor wire around the concentration around the capital of the United States right now. You got people roaming around saying this and saying this and saying that. We have the vaunted scientific elite agencies of the Centers for Disease Control and other kinds of things completely neutralized. I won't walk you through all of it. I suspect you all been reading the papers. You have some sense of what's going on. We aren't where we need to be. And the root of it turns out to be highly differentiated, unsuccessful outcomes for educational attainment across a huge swath of our society. Let's just put that into perspective. Every single year, we're producing 1 million new high school dropouts. 1 million new high school dropouts, give or take. Every single year, we're booting to the curb more than half the people that start college without finishing and with debt. More than $1 trillion of debt. So the people that have that debt, by the way, 85% of them did not graduate. The majority of the debt holders did not graduate. The massive debt holders. So I think, Susan, that might be far enough. And we can talk more about the specifics. But what you can imagine is that, we've decided over here, once Arizona got electricity back in 2002, you know, we could really embrace technology and find a way to move forward in lots of different kinds of ways. So that's 21 minutes, 30 seconds. So I'll stop there and see if you have comments or questions.
Thank you, Michael. I'm gonna take some prerogative here and ask the first question, and we'll see what else. But one of the things that I think would be a concern is that we know that there's a tendency to take good ideas and to ruin them. So
especially by greedy little bastards that run for-profit universities and other assaholic kind of individuals.
So how do we think about the fact that we are going to have to use technology to meet the scale of needs that we have? And how do we prevent that from just becoming an accretion of accumulation of credentials, yeah, but still have, you know, the same ignorance that you currently have?
You know, I think that from our perspective, the key is faculty control. The key is our faculty are responsible. So Manfred's one of our faculty members, Phil's one of our faculty members, I'm one of our faculty members, others, we're in control. We determine what is this degree. We determine what is this course. And that's not true in a lot of what's going on. And I know, Susan, this isn't exactly what you're asking, but what I'm saying is that the root here is that we, the academy, have defaulted to the private sector to offer dog food instead of human food for human education. I mean, I mean that literally. I mean, it's not even the same thing. And because we defaulted, we're now seeing billions of dollars of public investment being wasted, people graduating with degrees that don't really have the kind of understandings that they need to have. This is not true for all of them, but it's true for most of them. And so the key is that most faculties, particularly at research grade institutions or particularly at scholarly active institutions, have resisted technology because they believe that it's a dilution of their role or the way things that need to be designed or whatever. And so the simple answer I give you is that universities and colleges and others need to control, you know, the use of these technologies, the outcomes of the learning processes, the measurement of the learning outcomes, and then also people need to be held accountable for outcomes. So what do you think at one of the local community colleges here, what do you think the cost is to produce a single associate's degree? It's $275,000 because no one graduates. No one's accountable for that. The debt to degree ratio for the average run-of-the-mill for-profit university right now is $120,000. $120,000 of debt per degree. That's unsustainable. Who's accountable for that? You've got, for instance, inadequate academic accreditation, inadequate institutional accreditation, inadequate institutional oversight, lack of faculty control, faculty resistance. I mean, so what we have here is, what's the 4-year graduation rate of the California State University system with 23 campuses and 550,000 students? Under 20%. Now, there's lots of reasons for that. But these are things that the academy itself, if you're at University of Michigan or if you're at the University of Washington or you're at some other school that admits only A students, you know, you're not really in that world. You live in a different world. Maybe you're off in Plato's Academy and everybody else is in Chum City.
Michael, there's a few questions coming up in the chat, and yeah. I'd like to ask John Kagg, since he is, I see that he's on, to sort of ask the question, because I think many of them are summarized by some of the issues that he raised. So John, would you mind chiming in?
Sure. Hi, John.
Michael, hi. I'm one of your philosopher kings, hopefully not one of the bad type that you're describing.
Yes, there are good philosopher kings.
Well, so I'm a tenured professor of philosophy at UMass Lowell and a Miller Scholar at SFI, a former Miller Scholar. Thank you very much for your remarks. One question that I have is, it seems that if community colleges were actually affordable and put students at the center, there would be the question of whether the credits that they gain there would be easily transferable to accredited universities. Yeah. I'm wondering what the obstacles that you see are to that. It seems like a number of platforms have developed. I'm thinking about one that I'm involved in Outlier, developed by the founder of Masterclass, that has formed a relationship with Pitt that says that at $400 per class, that's not per credit, but per class, these credits will be transferable to Pitt, and everything's done online. And I'm wondering, how do we scale that model? Because it seems to me that they're not crap classes. There's serious quality there, and we have to figure out how to deliver it to a very wide swath of the population, and then to have these dog kennels that we call departments in universities allow those credits to enter. So how do you do that?
Yeah, so it's a fabulous question. So we've been working on that for some time. We have an entire office, by the way, just on the side, that does nothing but build relationships with community colleges and work as the interface between our academic departments and these community colleges, so that you take the right courses at the community college. You get at least such and such a grade in that course. We help you at the community college also. So we're trying to pathway people into our degree programs from community colleges. But your question is actually broader than that, which is other learning assets that might be available out there at a very low cost. And so what we're working on there, and Phil can talk about this, we're working on the trusted learner network idea, which is the building of a blockchain capability controlled again academically and controlled by our faculty from a quality control perspective, where, you know, not everything is good. So you take the good, you take the good, you take the good, you take the acceptable, and then you build a recognition by the faculties in these various, as you call them, dog kennels, for the dog food versus the people food. And you find a way in which you build this openness to the trusted learner network. And then each student then arrives, or each learner arrives, with a series of credentials or credential pathways in the trusted learner network that then allows you to now then engage UMass Lowell or wherever it is that you're trying to go with, you know, here's your package, and you've got a place to start. And then between the universities, you try to make this as simple for the student as you possibly can, or for the learner actually. So that is a highly complicated technological project. We've got a lot of work going on in that. There's some others that have some work going on in that. And so, John, that's a really important question. It does require the faculty to be open-minded. It does require the faculty to look at things in kind of a new way.
Thank you.
Okay. Can I address something that Susan has brought up a couple times here? Hi, everyone. I'm Josh Grochow. I'm a former SFI postdoc, now a professor in computer science and math at CU Boulder. Susan has raised a couple times what I think is a great point that actually dovetails with what Michael's been talking about she's phrased it as excellence versus egalitarianism. And the thing that I wanted to point out is, I don't think that there's a fundamental conflict there. But actually, part of the issue or one of the many things that feeds into the issue, is the whole idea of a synchronous course schedule, that not all students learn at the same rate. Not all students can learn at the same rate. Some have outside jobs. Some are taking care of family members. You know, some are taking care of themselves. Some have, you know, their own illnesses or disabilities that they have to take care of. And, you know, it's one of these things that's kind of baked into these traditional school systems of, we all think, oh, there are semesters or trimesters or quarters or whatever, and everything is synchronous and teaching comes to you in these fixed units that you then get credit for. And okay, you know, maybe we can't, you know, it's very hard to sort of overturn that whole system. But the reason I say this dovetails at least a little bit with what Michael's been talking about is one way to help relieve some of that pressure, that time pressure, is to allow learning to be asynchronous. And technology can certainly play a role in that.
Yeah, so Josh, I'll just take a stab at that. So our five realms, four of which are active, realm one, full immersion on-campus technology-enhanced learning, we have tried to break up the rigidity of the time clock by breaking our semesters up into two modules, allowing students to take seven-week courses, all kinds of things that we're doing there, and we're accelerating that even more, as well as also offering some courses and some technology tools that are then available whenever and always. And then on the asynchronous modality, which is our realm two, our courses there are available when you're available and are also greatly enhanced by tools for learning. So you're right. So this goes back to one of my earlier points, which is the rigidity, what I call limited adaptation to complexity, as one of the causalities. And so K-12 schools work on a rigid structure. Universities work on a rigid structure, mostly for the convenience. I'm not saying this in a bad way, but mostly for the convenience of the faculty. It's not really the way the rest of the society works. And so we're going to need more optionality. Technology allows us to produce some of that additional optionality. We're not even the same institution that we were a year ago, given COVID. We now have multiple ways to do full immersion, including what we're doing here. So I think, Josh, that notion of taking control of time, we call it time and speed. We've got to find a way to open up our optionality for the learners while, you know, helping the faculty to be as maximally productive as they can be.
If I may be a bit provocative from here's Daphne Beverly. I'm French. I worked for 25 years in the US and I'm now for 10 years in Switzerland. So I've seen three different educational systems. And I've actually been pretty struck by what the Swiss have been doing over the years. And in fact, what they have really questioned is, do we need 100% of the population to understand what RNA is, or do they need to trust rather their doctor about what RNA is? Like you trust your plumber when he comes to fix your faucet. And one of the things that they have done extremely well is to specialize people really early on, but that has the counterpoint to that is that society highly values our specialization. So being a plumber is something which is highly valued in society. It's not something that is seen as, you know, you failed your study and so we are going to put you in a path that is not the royal path. Mm-hmm. And so I'm questioning whether some of these issues are actually deeper and go back to what values do we want to put forward in the society we want to build, yeah, in order to properly get the majority of people to work to a place in the workforce where they actually feel at ease. Should we really expect 100% of people to understand what RNA is? Is this really our goal? Or is our goal that we actually educate people to fit where they feel their strength, their comfort zone, and they actually contribute positively to society and stop having this very, that you denounce them, like, you know, this like faculty as being at the top of the food chain, or like the CEO being at the top of the food chain, and rather reconsider what the variety of advantages that different skills bring to society.
Yeah, definitely. I think I agree with each of the points that you bring up, and I appreciate them very much. I don't know that Switzerland is necessarily a good role model for, you know, much larger democracies and complexities and so forth, but nonetheless, it's a fantastic laboratory to look at and see how things have been so successful there. So I appreciate that very much. I've been there very many, many times. I think you're right, this notion. I picked RNA not because someone has to have an intimate understanding of it, but they have to understand whether or not it's air or water or dirt or a tree. I'm talking about the most fundamental understanding of what something is. And again, that doesn't then necessarily take away from the fact that we have to trust others and we have to understand why we trust others and how we trust others. I will say something though, relative to educational attainment. I mean, we have something that's occurred relative to science where if we do not accelerate some additional levels of science literacy, scientists will soon become priests of a religion that no one actually understands. They're just told to believe it. And at some point that won't be functional because you have to have some actual understanding. Having said that, you're absolutely right in the notion that it's not one pathway. We need to find a way to have multiple pathways. We need to have find a way to have respect. I mean, one of the things that you're basically saying is we need to have higher levels of respect and recognition for all kinds of things. And so I'm using the stark terms that I'm using now to describe the situation in the United States, which is very different than the situation in Switzerland for lots of different reasons, social reasons, cultural reasons, scale reasons, economic reasons, heterogeneity reasons, you know, all of these kinds of things. But having said that, we do have to decide what is the minimal level of education. You know, we did decide that we wanted everybody to be able to read. We did decide that we wanted everyone to be able to count. We did decide that we wanted everybody to have some fundamental understanding of science. Well, we can't just keep that the same. That has to continue to accelerate. And then right now, and I think at the core of one of the points that I made, at least in the US, very different than Switzerland or France. My wife's from a French family. You're not getting 20% high school dropout rates in these places, you know, where people don't even finish high school, don't even have fundamental understanding of things. So Daphne, I would take your basic admonition and be very cautious. What you're saying is to be cautious about how we design, how we move ahead. And so I appreciate that. And we could spend more time talking about it. I've Susan got to take off at this point, but Daphne, I do appreciate your question and wish that we had more time to talk about it. So it's a very important point.
Yeah, no, thank you.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Michael. And we've been monitoring the chat. I'm sure some of these questions will come up later, and I'm glad that we'll have Phil here to help us navigate through some of them. So thank you again for your time, and good luck with the rest of your day.
All right, nice to see you guys.